Okay, let's look at some functions of cell. So I'm talking about a living cell here. So one important function is it maintains boundaries. You know that you have the cell membrane on the outside which maintains boundaries. So, you know, it allows one cell to get close to another. There's a cell-to-cell interaction. The cell kind of has a distinct shape and size. All living cells metabolize. They take in oxygen. They produce carbon dioxide. They use ATP. All cells are capable of digestive processes inside. So this is at the cellular level. They excrete waste products. Most of the time, the waste product is carbon dioxide. Most cells are capable of reproduction. One exclusion being, does anybody remember? Red blood cell, yes, very good. So the red blood cell does not have a nucleus, so it's not capable of reproduction. It's yet a living cell. However, there are certain cells in our body which were capable of reproduction, but as you know, in fetal life or when development was going on, these were capable of reproduction, but then they get highly specialized and later in life they stop reproducing. So even though they have a nucleus, they don't reproduce. Can anyone think of some cells? Muscle cell, yes. So if a muscle cell is damaged, it is replaced by scar tissue. Nerve cells in the brain, for example, in the peripheral nervous system, the axon is capable of regenerating, but in the central nervous system, and you may have heard of stem cell research which is going on for this, so because fetal cells are put inside to aid in reproduction, so in the brain, in the central nervous system, no regeneration occurs because these cells are not capable of reproducing. So they've lost the ability to reproduce because the more highly developed they get, the regenerative capability comes down. Okay, so these are some exceptions. Cells are capable of movement. They don't necessarily have to move from one place to the other, but, you know, you will see in many places just by having cilia, for example, they show movement. You have microvilli. We'll talk about all of this. So cells are capable of movement. And when stimulated, they're capable of showing a reaction. So there is an interaction with the environment, which we call irritability. Okay? So these are some features of functions of a cell. There are certain cells in the body which are rapidly dividing. Give me some examples. So I gave you an example of how muscle and nervous tissue don't divide as rapidly. Think of areas where cells would divide very rapidly. Skin, yes, very good. So in the skin, it's actually what is called the epidermis, which regenerate. So this epidermis is part of something which we will talk of as epithelium. Okay, so it's the epidermis of the skin that you mentioned, but epidermis is part of a tissue which is called epithelial tissue, and we'll see everywhere in the body epithelial tissue is capable of very rapid regeneration. The reason being, epithelial tissue is either present on the outside, like epidermis on the outside of your body, or it lines organs inside, you know. So then it's constantly being abraded. The reason you probably mentioned skin is that, you know, you're constantly either scratching, hitting yourself, doing something. There's a lot of abrasion or friction that happens between the skin and the environment. The same goes on for, imagine your esophagus, the lining of the esophagus. You eat foods of different types, textures, temperatures. So again, it can be constantly abraded. So you want it to regenerate really fast. So epithelium is one area where regeneration occurs very fast. The cells are very, very rapidly dividing. Any other area? When you say white blood cells, it's not only white blood cells, but all the blood cells. So in bone marrow, okay? All the blood cells. So in bone marrow. Hair follicles too, very rapidly dividing. You all know you lose hair every day, right? It kind of comes back on really fast. So these are some areas of the body where cells are very rapidly dividing. And here's where I would like you to kind of think critically. You know, you've seen patients of cancer, right? What happens to them? They lose their hair, isn't it? You also may have heard that these people often suffer from anemia because they have bone marrow depression. And they also have nausea and vomiting. You know, they have gastrointestinal upsets quite a lot of time. The reason this happens is that when anyone suffers from cancer, you give them drugs where you want to target the cancer cells. And cancer cells are very rapidly dividing. But they are not dividing rapidly in a purposeful manner. It is not purposeful at all. So, you know, they just in a very haphazard manner, which is why you have this clump which forms a tumor. So in order to destroy tumors, we give them drugs which are known as chemotherapeutic drugs. You give chemotherapeutic drugs to destroy cancers. But one of the side effects of this drug is, since the drugs are aimed at rapidly dividing cells, what they do, they can't choose between normal rapidly dividing cells and abnormal rapidly dividing cells. So not only do they attack the cancer cells, they also attack other cells in the body which are rapidly dividing, which are like your hair follicles. That's why your hair falls off when people undergo chemotherapy. They also have bone marrow depression and have anemia, because if the bone marrow is depressed, you're not able to form white blood cells, red blood cells, you have anemia. They're more prone to infections because white blood cell count is low. And they also have, like I said, nausea, vomiting, and so on, because the epithelium, especially in the GI tract, is not being regenerated fast enough. So when it's destroyed, then, you know, it cannot regenerate, you get all kinds of gastrointestinal upsets, okay? So this is where you kind of, whenever now you start looking at commercials or ads, try and sort of, whatever you're learning in class, try and kind of relate it to what is being told. So this is one example of a clinical application of knowing where cells are rapidly dividing. Now here let's look at parts of a typical cell. The outer membrane of the cell is called the cell membrane, or also known as the plasma membrane. We'll use the term plasma membrane. Then inside, this is filled. That cell is filled with a jelly-like substance, which is known as cytoplasm, most of which is water. And then we have a nucleus, which has that DNA, right, which is the control center of the cell. And that also has a membrane, which is called the nuclear membrane. And you have a little nucleolus inside. And you'll notice that when I drew the cell membrane and the nuclear membrane, this plasma membrane and the nuclear membrane, kind of drew it a little dotted, just to say that these have little pores in them. And the plasma membrane, you will see later, we'll talk about it. It is what we say as being selectively permeable. The word permeable means to allow substances to pass in and out. Being selectively permeable means to allow only certain substances to pass in or out, okay? And that helps us, because you don't want everything, you want nutrients to get into the cell and you want waste products to get out of the cell. So can you see that? So how it selectively allows nutrients in, allows waste products to go out. So our plasma membrane is selectively permeable. So let's look at this plasma membrane. And this is often described as a fluid mosaic model, because if you look at it, just if you look at this part from the top, can you look? It looks like a little mosaic over there, because you've got all these purple things which are proteins. You've got these little gray things which are the phospholipid parts. You've got these little green things which are called glycoprotein or glycolipids. So it kind of looks, has a little bit of a mosaic appearance. So that's the mosaic part. And it's fluid in nature. In other words, that all these proteins can actually move around from one part to the other. So it's got fluid. They're not kind of stuck in that space. Okay. So this is why we give it we use the term fluid mosaic model. So let's look at some of the parts of the cell membrane. It's what is called a double layer of phospholipids. Phospholipid means a lipid, which is fat, with a phosphate molecule attached to it. So that's why it's called phospholipid. And then we have proteins and cholesterol also scattered in it. So proteins and cholesterol as well. So let's look at this double layer of phospholipids. So when you first look at it, it kind of looks a bit busy and a little difficult to understand. But let's kind of break it down. So in chemistry, remember we did polar molecules and we did non-polar, okay? So here we're going to use some of them. So you can, as I said, double layer of phospholipid. So here is one layer of phospholipid and here is the other layer of phospholipid. And if you look at the phospholipid molecule, it has a globular head with two tails. And from here, like this. So can you see one layer? And this is the second layer. And what happens, what you're noticing is that the tails are facing each other. Can you see that? The tails are facing each other. So if this is the plasma membrane here, this is the outside. This blue area is the extracellular environment. So that's watery in nature. And this part here, this area here, is the inside of the cell. So this is where the cytoplasm is. And remember I told you cytoplasm also is watery, right? Water was a polar molecule, you remember? When we did chemistry, water is a polar molecule. So you want something that loves water on the inside, and you also want something that loves water on the outside so that it will kind of interact properly with water. So towards the ends of this double layer is these little rounded heads. These are called the polar heads of phospholipid molecules, or they are also known as hydrophilic. Means water loving. So it's hydrophilic here and it's hydrophilic towards the here, this part. The heads, okay? Can you see that? The heads there. In the center where the tails are, this tail part, this is non-polar, which you can see here, and this is called hydrophobic. This does not like water, phobia for not liking something. So here we have the double layer of phospholipid molecules with the heads, which are hydrophilic or polar. They are present towards the outside, towards the extracellular fluid, and they're also present towards the inside, which means towards the cytoplasm. The tails face each other, and the tails are hydrophobic. That means they don't like water, okay? Seen interspersed in this phospholipid bilayer, you have cholesterol molecules. You can see this yellow substance, which is present here. These are the cholesterol molecules. Cholesterol is very important because it gives stability to the plasma membrane. It is what gives fluidity. So if the temperature is too cold, what it will do is it will try and make the plasma membrane more fluid. Because what happens in very cold temperature, fat will tend to congeal, right? To become solid. So what it will try to do, it doesn't want that to happen. So it will make it more fluid. In very hot temperature, what will happen? It will tend to melt. So it will make it less fluid. So that's how it lends fluidity to the plasma membrane, gives stability. So that's why, you know, while most of the time cholesterol is given a bad name because everybody says have a low cholesterol diet, don't eat too much and so on. You can understand that cholesterol does have a purpose in our life. Everywhere in the body, cells are surrounded by plasma membrane, which requires cholesterol. So you can see that cholesterol has a big role to play in our body, okay? Second is you can see these protein molecules which are present. Can you see these protein molecules, this ones in purple? They are present in, again, this phospholipid bilayer. They're either present through and through, that means from the entire, they occupy the entire length of the phospholipid bilayer. Where they are known, when they occupy the entire length, they are known as integral proteins, or also known as membrane proteins, or sometimes called transmembrane proteins. Transmembrane meaning going across the membrane. So integral proteins or transmembrane proteins. And then we have some which only show up on the top, you can only see a little bit on the top. They may be attached to a transmembrane or they may be present separately just like that. So you can see just a little bit on the top. They're not right through and through. So they can be on the top towards the extracellular side or they can be at the bottom towards the cytoplasm side. Can you see these? These are known as peripheral proteins. By the name itself, peripheral means towards the periphery or the outside. So they are all the right on top or right at the bottom. Okay.
So can it look different than the other one? Can we shape?
This one?
Okay, there's the first purple one.
Yeah, this is a peripheral which is on the top of this one. And can you see this one? This is on the bottom part. So this is facing the cytoplasm. This here is facing the extracellular environment.
So then, but that's a different section, like the third one. You see the third one?
This one?
No, the third one is open. Integral protein?
Yes.
So this, that's just...
Integral is through and through.
Okay.
Integral is through and through. This is just attached. This happens to be attached to an integral protein. It may not be attached. It may be present just separately like that. So integral protein is just this part. Okay? This part. This is an integral protein. This part is an integral protein. This is an integral protein. This is an integral protein.
You mean the lining of it?
No, the whole thing is the integral. The whole thing is the integral protein. This whole thing is the integral protein. This is just a cut section it is showing you. A peripheral protein may be attached. So if this is the integral protein, a peripheral protein may be attached to an integral protein on the top. It may be attached to an integral protein at the bottom, or it may be present like this without being attached to an integral protein at all. But it's just on the periphery. Can you understand? It's not through and through. Yeah. So that, yes. This one, it could be either one of them because they've drawn, for now, they've just drawn it like that. But it could be either one. It could be what is called a channel protein, or it could also be those carrier molecules which help to assist. Yeah. So it could be either. So we won't sort of break it down to anything. So here, when we look at the functions of proteins, we'll come to that. So you're a little ahead of yourself. So here, so this is the... This is integral protein, which occupies the entire length. Peripheral proteins, by the name, that means they're on the periphery. They're either right on the top, just up here, or here, right here at the bottom. So they don't occupy the entire length. Yeah. I'll come to it. Okay. Then you have a third part where you have attached to some of these, the peripheral proteins or the integral proteins, you have a carbohydrate part which is attached to it, glyco for glucose. So when they are attached to the protein, it's called glycoprotein. When they are attached to the lipid part of this bilayer, then it's called a glycolipid. So can you see that glycoprotein, where you have this carbohydrate molecule attached to the protein part? It could be attached here to the integral proteins or the peripheral proteins. And then you have some carbohydrate part attached to this polar heads of the phospholipid bilayer. So then they're called glycolipid, lipid for the lipid part of it and glycose for the glucose. Okay? So let's look at the functions now of the glyco complexes and the proteins. Since you asked about the glyco complexes, this glyco, we together, these are known as glycocalyx. The glycoprotein and glycolipids, we can just call them as glycocalyx. They are important in what is known as cell-to-cell recognition. You can see how they are present on the top. They are attached on the top. So they are like sticking out at the top of the cell where they are in contact with this outer environment. So here they are in your body, they take part. When I say cell-to-cell recognition, they act like little markers. Can you see they're kind of sticking out on top? They act like little markers in the body. And when I say cell-to-cell interaction, if a foreign cell comes into your body, this marker, this glycoprotein or glycolipid, it can differentiate between a cell which belongs to your body and it can differentiate between a cell that does not belong to your body. When it differentiates as the cell which is part of your body, it recognizes it as a self cell. It says, oh, this belongs to me, I'm going to leave it alone. When it recognizes another cell which is foreign to your body, it says, this is non-self. So now I need to attack it. So that's when the immune, so this is very important in the immune response. So when you have, for example, one example I can give you, like you have people who have transplant rejections. Right? They have transplants in their body. It's transplanted from another person who has a great degree of similarity, but not total. So now whenever the part is rejected, it is because this cell sees there must be something in that which is foreign to it. And so the immune response comes about and that cell is rejected. That part is rejected. And we'll do more of this when we do the immune system. But for here, what you can see here is that it allows body cells to recognize cells which are part of the body and cells which are foreign. So it takes part in the immune response by raising these flags on the top. Okay?
So why is it that it doesn't attack cancer cells, or does it?
It does. Actually, it does. So it's part of the immune. It does. It's part of the immune response. You have something called cell-mediated immune response, where the body cells do attack cancer cells. But it's just so that they get overwhelmed. You see, and then you cannot take care of all of it. Even when you get an infection in your body, quite often you might get an infection and you may not manifest with the disease. Sometimes you know, streptococcal, so you get a sore throat and goes away after some time and you're fine, but sometimes you get a really bad sore throat. So in the time that it goes in, maybe your body was able to take care of it. Your immune response was good enough. When it is not good enough and it was overwhelmed, that's when you manifest with the disease. So, okay, so just because it recognizes it doesn't mean it can always take care of it. Okay? So that's the function of, yes. Okay, well, we are going a little bit out of it. But anyway, whenever you have a transplant rejection, there are many parts to it. The first is recognizing this is foreign, which is done by these markers, okay, like these glycocalyx parts. Then it has to call upon the immune response to take care of that problem. Like, look, I've got a foreign body inside me. I've got to get rid of it. And you have macrophages and other cells which are phagocytic, which will kind of come and attack that area, okay? And you have something called cytotoxic T lymphocytes, which will come there. When you take drugs which prevent this, you know, you take these suppressants, what they do is they suppress the immune response. So they prevent the macrophages from going there. So in other words, the white blood cell population, which is supposed to take care of it, is prevented from doing its job. So with the result, these people, they cancer, the rejection doesn't occur, but at the same time, they're more prone to infections because the immune response has been dampened. Follow? Okay. Okay, let's come to the function of the protein. So we talked about all of these integral proteins and these surface proteins. So let's look at some of their functions. So one function is that some of these proteins may act as enzymes. The others, can you see that they are present here going right through? So they help the cell interact with its environment. So they help the cell interact with the environment. They also help the cell, as you will see in the next few slides, they help one cell interact with the cell next to it, so they help in the attachment of cells. So we'll see when we do these junctions, gap junctions and tight junctions and a desmosome. So you'll see it is because of these proteins that cells stay connected to some cells and they allow substances to pass through them, or they may not allow substances to pass through them. So that's the interaction that they allow, okay? So they're allowing substances to pass or not pass, or keeping cells close to each other. So that's another function of these proteins. Then the proteins often have channels through them where they allow ions and water molecules, and sometimes they may even act as carrier proteins where they allow very large molecules which need to cross from one part to the other, but they can't cross this lipid bilayer, so they help in transport of these molecules, which again we will see. So you can see a lot of functions that these protein molecules have. So they have in transport, they have a function in acting as enzymes. They may also act as receptors, especially these peripheral proteins. They may act as receptors for hormones. So certain hormones have to come and get attached to them. They also act as channels or as carrier proteins. So they allow small molecules and ions to pass through. And as carrier proteins, they sort of change the structure and help very large molecules be ferried across from one side of the cell to the other. So we'll see all this, okay? So these are some of the properties of proteins and why we have these proteins present in the plasma membrane. Now you looked at that slide, so see which of these is the correct statement. The polar heads are pointed towards the center of the membrane, or the non-polar heads are oriented towards the interior of the cell next to the cytoplasm, or do the polar heads face the interior and exterior with the tails forming the center of the membrane? Okay, it's the third one, C, is the right answer. The polar heads are not pointed towards the center of the membrane, and the non-polar tails are not towards the interior. The heads, remember, faced the outside and the inside of the cell, and the tails were the center of the membrane. So again, it's very important to look at the slide very carefully. So notice this. These are the polar heads. So can you see this? Towards the exterior of the cell and up here too, towards the interior. So you can see they're facing the exterior and the interior. And notice these, the non-polar tails are in the center. Okay? Okay. So the polar heads face the interior and exterior of the cell with the tails forming the center of the membrane. So here the tails were forming the center of the membrane. You can see here, they form the center. This is towards the exterior. This head is towards the interior. Okay? Now here, membrane junction. So this is the first of the thing where I told you how proteins become important. Now except for a few cells which kind of migrate through the body, like, you know, maybe sperm cells, some red blood cells, and so on, most other cells in the body are... There's an interaction with the cell next to it. So they're, you know, they're closely sort of bound to each other. And when they're bound, we get some of what we call cell junctions, or also known as membrane junctions. So let's look at them. There are three types of these junctions. The first one is called a tight junction. And this is an example of a tight junction. And as the name suggests, they are impermeable. They are tight. So they do not allow substances to pass from the extracellular space into the cell. So they prevent anything passing from the extracellular space into the cell. And so they are because of these proteins which kind of interlock in such a manner that they form these junctions, and they're really tight. And one good example is in the gastrointestinal tract, where, you know, bacteria or enzymes from the cell, they are not able to pass out and get into the bloodstream. So that's one example where this is present. So they don't pass out of the cell and get into the bloodstream, which is the extracellular space. The second type of cell junction, again, where these proteins come into use, is something known as desmosomes. So this part here, where these are known as, and a good way for it is anchoring junctions. So what they do is they bind adjacent cells. So this is one cell here, this is one cell here, and this is another one here. And they bind the two cells together. So can you see they're bound together by little proteins which go across, and these are known as linking or linker glycoproteins. So they just keep them across. And they help to distribute the tension, the stress which is placed on a cell. They help to kind of distribute it evenly all through. They keep these cells together because they're kind of, you know, attached. They pull from this side. So they anchor one cell to the other. And a good place you see this is that when you next, when you look in the under the microscope, you look at a layer of the skin, at the epidermis of the skin, you will find, because when we kind of process the tissue and use alcohol, it shrinks the cells, and you can actually see some of the cells in the epidermis are called prickle cell layer, and you can act, they're called prickle cell because the desmosomes actually kind of become visible because the cell has shrunk, but the desmosomes are still keeping it anchored to the cell next to it, so it looks like spiny and thorny, okay? The third is what is called gap junction. Yes, you had a question? Not necessary, no. Gap junctions are where there is communication, there's a gap. as the name suggests. So it helps to communicate. There is communication between one cell and the other. So, you know, ions and other substances can pass from one cell to the other. And this is usually present where you need fast activity and you need electrical impulses to pass from one cell to the other. And a good example of this is like the heart muscle. You know, you want electrical impulses to pass from one cardiac cell to the other cardiac cell and want it to pass fast so that smooth movement can come about. So this is one area in the body where gap junctions are very prevalent. Okay? So this is just kind of a review of the properties and functions of the plasma membrane. We took each part of it individually, so now we can look at some of it together. So as I mentioned earlier, it's selectively permeable. It doesn't allow any and everything to pass through. And this selective permeability depends on the size of the molecule. Very big molecules find it very difficult to pass through. And one very good example is albumin. It's a very, very large molecule. And you will see, normally does not get filtered out in, it pass, you know, your blood is passing through the kidney tubules and it gets filtered and then waste product passes out as urine. Albumin is a molecule which normally does not pass through the filtration membrane of the kidney. Filtration membrane is a part which will allow certain substances to pass through and not others. If this plasma membrane, which is part of that filtration membrane, if it was damaged, albumin actually can pass out and you will find albumin in the urine. And later when we do osmotic pressure and so on, I'll tell you what will be the result on the body. And so people then have kidney disease and they have associated problems with that. Okay? So size of the molecule is very important. Large molecules do not pass through unless the plasma membrane is damaged. Solubility. If anything which is lipid soluble, because the plasma membrane is made up of a bilipid layer. So lipid soluble molecules and small molecules pass through quite easily. Others pass through only with assistance, or if they are very large, they do not pass through at all. Okay. Charge also, charged molecules have a lot of kinetic energy. So you find ions, like remember we did ions, sodium, potassium, chloride and so on. Those are small molecules, they are able to pass through. And again, many of them do need some assistance, but charged molecules find it easier to pass through. The plasma membrane is the outermost covering of a cell, so obviously it is protective. If it is torn, then, you know, the cytoplasm would leak out, right? It allows for transport. We just said, like, you know, the proteins present in the plasma membrane, they allow either they form channels or they form what are called carrier proteins, which we will see, or you might have substances which are lipid soluble, which can pass right through. So there's transport of substances to and fro. The outside of the cell and the inside of a cell, they have a relative charge. The outside of the cell is the outside of the cell, especially when you look at muscle and nerve cells, especially when we are looking at muscle and nerve cells. The outside is more positively charged compared to the inside of the cell. And we call this a resting membrane potential. So this resting membrane potential comes into play, especially when we are describing nerve and muscle cells. And the outside is more positively charged compared to the inside. When a nerve impulse comes, it changes the permeability of that cell membrane. So now when we do muscle and nerve, you'll see. So positive ions begin to move inside and it changes that resting membrane potential, which is what actually starts about the beginning of a muscle contraction. So, you know, when someone tells you to go pick up something and you without thinking just go and pick it up, a lot really happens physiologically inside. So actually a nerve impulse has to come down, the membrane potential changes, you know, ions move in, then they move out and, you know, changes occur inside the muscle cell itself, a lot of changes occur, and then finally contraction occurs. So this resting membrane potential, we'll talk about it more when we come to nerve and muscle cell. Okay, but just remember this, that at the resting level, the outside is more positively charged compared to the inside. I also told you about the cell environment interaction, you know, the irritability, the receptors which are present, how cells react to the to other cells, what happens on the outside, hormones come, you have those receptors, you know, and the receptors are specific to certain hormones. So that again is all because of the plasma membrane and those proteins which are present on the surface. Now, in some areas of the body, the plasma membrane is specialized to carry out certain functions. Three of the specializations are these which you see, microvilli, cilia, and flagella. Microvilli increase the surface area of the cell. And why would you want to increase the surface area? You want to increase the surface area both for secretion. If you have a greater surface area, more can be secreted, and for absorption, you can also absorb more. So where do you think microvilli would be more prevalent? In which part of the body? Urinary, well, this is a cell. You don't want to absorb anything in the urinary tract. And when you secrete, yes, I can understand secretion, but you don't want to absorb. You do have microvilli in certain parts of the urinary tract, but that wouldn't be the first part that I would think of. But you do have when you do urinary system. Yes? Digestive? Yes. Digestive is, pardon?
No.
Digestive is one area, because what does the digestive tract do? It secretes enzymes, right, which act on the foodstuff. And then the food is broken down. Then you need to absorb that food in order for it to get into your bloodstream, those nutrients, right? So the digestive tract is one area where you have microvilli and plenty of it. So let's see how the microvillus actually increases the surface area. So imagine if you have a cell which is this way. So this is all the surface of the cell, okay? If I take the same cell in this much area and I fold the plasma membrane like this, you know, like an accordion, can you see now if I was to unravel this, it would be much longer than just from point A to B. Can you see this, how our surface membrane has been, surface area has been increased? So this is the microvillus. These, each one is a microvillus, together they are called microvilli. So what are these? These are because of the infolding of the plasma membrane. Can you see this? It folds in. This infolding is also known as invagination. So invagination of plasma membrane, forming these numerous folds, increasing the surface area. So you can both secrete more now, and you can also absorb through this. Okay? Seen in the GI tract, a lot of it you will see in the small intestine, where a lot of activity goes on. You will see microvilli over there. When you look under it, under the microscope, you can't see under the light microscope, you can't see this specific, you can't see this folding that well. Usually what it does is you can see kind of a little, you can see these lines on the top of the cell. So it looks like a brush over there. So microvilli are often known as a brush border. So it looks like a brush. That area has got like a little brush, okay? So it's known as brush border. In comparison to this, cilia are protrusions from the cell, and they're thin hair-like protrusions from the cell. So they're attached at the bottom of the cell like this. So they do nothing to increase the surface area because they're thin and hair-like. So these are cilia, and because they are hair-like, what they can do is they can beat, you know, like they can, when they beat together, they kind of form a wave-like pattern, and they beat in a certain direction. All the cilia will beat in a certain direction, and they help to move cell debris, or they even help to move, set up currents where, you know, a fluid current is set up and something can roll along. So I'll give you two examples of this. In the respiratory tract, right from your nasal cavity all the way down to the large bronchi, the epithelium, the cells have the cilia. Because, you know, you breathe air, but the air has so many pollutants in it. And, you know, that goes inside. So not only do you want to get rid of the pollutants, you want to make sure that they don't sort of go all the way down into your lungs, right? So from the nasal cavity, the cilia in the epithelium, they beat towards the back of your throat so that, you know, you can just swallow whatever is there. And then from the trachea and the bronchi and so on, they beat upwards so that you can actually cough it out because you don't want it to go in the lungs. So can you see that how it helps to remove the cell debris, the small particulate matter, which you may not even see because after all, this is microscopic, okay? And this is the reason why in smokers, when you smoke, it actually destroys the cilia. So with the result, this protective function of the cilia is lost. And then they are more prone to respiratory infections. That's the problem. And that's why you see some of the particulate matter in smokers, like the carbon particles, actually being deposited in the interalveolar septa. So that's one of the things. The second example I gave you was like it sets up currents. In the uterine tube or the fallopian tube in the females, again, that has ciliated epithelium. That means the cells have cilia. Now, the egg, the ovum is a very, very large cell. It's the largest cell in the body. And the ovum is picked up from the ovary by the fallopian tube. So if this is the uterus and here's the fallopian tube on either side, and here's the ovary, the ovum, which is thrown out from the ovary, is picked up from the fallopian tube and it has to travel all the way and get into the uterus. But the fallopian tube is a very, very narrow tube. And the ovum actually has to roll along. So what kind of helps it to roll along? It's actually the cells here, they have cilia. And the fallopian tube also produces a small amount of fluid. So the cilia all beat towards the uterus. When they beat towards the uterus, they set up a fluid current. That fluid current helps to roll the cell along. The cilia by themselves cannot move the cell because it's so large. So they set up a fluid current and that helps to roll the ovum along and that comes into the fallopian tube, into the uterus and, you know, whatever happens there. Okay? So that's the function of the cilia. It's protective in the case, in both cases, even in the up here in the fallopian tube and in the nasal cavity and the respiratory tract. And the idea is to set up a wave when they beat together, to set up a wave to either capture and or prevent particulate matter from getting into the lungs or to set up a current, for example, in the case of the ova. Yes.
You said cilia, a person smokes damages that.
Yes.
Does that mean throughout the body?
No, well, especially in the lungs because you inhale. Yeah, in the lungs. Yeah, in the lungs. And the next one is flagellum. Flagella or flagellum is singular. So flagellum is seen in the sperm. In the humans, it's the only place you actually see it in the sperm. And here what happens is when the sperms are being formed in the testes, actually in the beginning the sperms look like this and they're called spermatids. And then the sperm actually undergoes a structural change where this is such a big cell, so this cannot move. You need something. The flagellum is like a tail and it can kind of wave around like this and push, cause motion and help to propel the cell forwards. So here, this sperm now changes, this thing called a spermatid. It actually changes and becomes a sperm like this. It loses a lot of its cytoplasm and it gains a tail. So this is the flagellum. Flagella is singular, flagellum is plural. This helps to propel the sperm so that it can travel through the uterus and into the fallopian tube and meet the ovum and help to fertilize the egg. In a man, about 60% of the sperms are supposed to be normal in order to say that this male will be capable of fertilizing an ovum. Because not all sperms which are produced in the testes, not all of them are normal. 60% at least should be normal. It's quite likely that 40% or even more could be abnormal. If more than 40 are abnormal, then there could be a problem. Then reproduction becomes a problem. The reason being, if they lack a flagellum or they have double flagella where then they become heavy, they're not able to move around, then the sperms are not able to do their job, right? So that's why the importance of having a flagellum. So very often when men find that they are not capable of fertilization, there is a problem for, you know, impregnating a woman, they often see that either, there could be a lot of problems. One of the things could be that the sperms are lacking a flagella. Or, you know, it could be that the sperms have double heads or double tails, which make them very heavy and so they're not able to move around. Okay, let's answer this question. So in the body, there are some areas which are subject to a degree of mechanical stress. So which of the following types of membrane junctions would you expect to be more prevalent? Okay, some more. Ooh. Okay, the correct answer is desmosomes. And here's why. If you remember, desmosomes are called, remember I gave them the name anchoring junctions. Remember, they keep the cells attached to each other, like they pull from either side. So these are important, and I also told you that they help to distribute the stress evenly. And so these desmosomes are really important. That's what prevents cells from tearing, because they kind of keep the cells anchored to each other. They prevent it from tearing. So desmosomes is the correct answer to this.
So when you're talking about mechanical
stress, like the skin, that's why in the skin. You see, skin has a lot of mechanical stress put on it, so that you have, that's why you have a lot of desmosomes in the skin.
So that they're not tight junctions?
No, they're not tight junctions, they're desmosomes.
Okay.
Let's look at, then we said one of the functions of the plasma membrane was transport. So we have substances which are transported across the plasma membrane. So let's look at one method of transport, which is known as passive process. When we say passive process, that means no energy is utilized. No energy meaning no ATP is utilized. So no ATP. It also is a process which goes down the concentration gradient. So it goes down the concentration or pressure gradient. So when I say along the concentration gradient or along the pressure gradient, I'm actually meaning down the concentration or pressure gradient. That means it goes from an area of high concentration or pressure to an area of low concentration or pressure. Okay, so that's down the concentration gradient from high to low. So that's going down the concentration gradient. No energy is utilized. So this is passive process. This helps to transport a lot of substances into the cell or even out of the cell, where depending on where the concentration is higher and where the concentration is lower. So let's look at some examples of this. The first one is known as simple diffusion. So we'll call this simple diffusion. This uses the concentration gradient, not pressure. This uses the concentration gradient. So it goes from high to low. Remember, in passive, it's always from high to low. So it goes from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. Very, very small molecules, and especially lipid-soluble substances and gases, use this process. And just to give you an example, if I was to take a perfume bottle and, you know, just sort of spray it over here. So this would be the area where it would be highly concentrated. And then after some time, you will find the entire room would be filled with the aroma, right? In the beginning, you would smell it here, and then it would kind of spread across over there, right? So this is diffusion. So it's going from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. Everywhere else is low. In your body, if you think of it, in the when you go to the lungs, so if this is an air sac in the lung, the air sac is known as an alveolus, and this is a capillary, which is close to the lung, okay? The lung is lined by a very thin squamous epithelium. So you breathe in oxygen. So the air inside your alveolus has more oxygen in it. Your blood, which is returning from your body, has more carbon dioxide. And from your body, it goes into the heart, and from the heart, it's going to the lung. So here, we've reached the lung. So this is the lung, and this is the blood vessel. So there's more carbon dioxide in this blood vessel. There's more oxygen in this blood, in this alveolus. So now, because the concentration of carbon dioxide, which is a gas, is more in the capillary, what happens is it diffuses from here into the alveolus. So can you see from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration? Because there's less carbon dioxide in the lungs. I'm going to draw it, write it real small. In the lung, on the other hand, oxygen is at a greater concentration compared to the blood vessel. So oxygen diffuses into the capillary here. Can you see that? When carbon dioxide goes from the capillary into the alveolus, this is what you breathe out. Remember, you breathe in and you breathe out. You breathe in oxygen and you breathe out carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide is actually coming from this blood vessel. This oxygen which you breathe in goes now into the blood vessel. From here, it will go to the body where it will go and feed the tissues. You breathe in oxygen so that your tissues can get oxygen. Can you see that? So can you see how gases are simply diffusing here? Okay, so this is one example. So like this, we will see other very often in many parts of the body, wherever there's a high concentration of some substance. So for example, sodium, sodium may not be a good example, but let's say, what can I think of? Well, it come back to me. For now, let's look at gases as being the best example of diffusion from an area of high concentration to an area of low concentration. Okay, so this is simple diffusion. So it just goes across the cell membrane. We have a second case where the diffusion is not so simple because the molecule is a little large, or it may not be lipid soluble. So like large molecule like sugars or amino acids or some ions which need help. So they need to be facilitated. They need something to help them. So then, instead of going simply through the cell membrane, what they do is they will go through channels in the protein. So in the protein, there are channels which are present here like this. So they will pass through the channels which help them to go from the outside to the inside or vice versa. Or there may be special proteins which are present, which are known as carrier proteins. These are called carrier proteins, which somehow kind of change structurally. They cause a little change. So you will see that. I can't show it to you just in a drawing. I'll show it to you in that video. So they change structurally and they help to transport from the outside. They take it, they turn around, and then they push it into the cell and they come back to their original position. Okay? So they are helped across. So these are, that is what is known as facilitated. So you're facilitating this diffusion. So that's called facilitated diffusion. A third type of diffusion, but here it involves pressure and not concentration. This is known as filtration, and this occurs in capillaries or even veins. And this is from an area of high pressure to an area of low pressure. And one very good example is in the kidneys. A really good example is in the kidneys. So if you look at the kidney, and you know, blood flows into the kidney and goes out, and urine is formed, right? But your urine does not contain red blood cells and all proteins and other things. It contains only small ions and stuff like that. So when blood is passing through, the pressure inside is much more. So because of that pressure, and the capillaries in the kidney have small little like gap junctions, so they allow substances which are small to be filtered through because the pressure is higher here than here. This filtrate which passes through will later form urine. And others which are large molecules, they pass back into the blood and they remain in your bloodstream. So can you see it's going from an area of high pressure to an area of low pressure? Okay? So that is called filtration. And the pressure, because it is fluid pressure, we often call this pressure hydrostatic pressure. One good example I can give you of hydrostatic pressure is that imagine you have a water hose, okay? And you turn on the tap and you've attached this hose to it. And you make holes inside your hose. And if your tap, the pressure in the of water when you turn on the tap is not very high, the fluid will come out of those holes in the hose very, very slowly. You turn on the tap a little better, more water coming through, it comes out even faster, right? It's because of the fluid pressure inside. If you put a nozzle at the other end, you build up pressure inside, it'll come out even more, isn't it? So that is fluid pressure. So in your body, one example is, of course, this filtration like I gave you. The other is, many of you must have noticed that when you travel for long distances in an aircraft and you're sitting for a long time, let's say a 5-hour flight or even longer than that, and you haven't moved around for a while, your shoes become, when you get off the flight, your shoes become a little tight, right? Your feet swell, isn't it? Have you noticed that? It happens quite often, especially, maybe not like 3-hour flight, but take one of those international flights where you're sitting for more than 5-6 hours and you're just sitting without having moved around, your feet do swell up. The reason for this is that what happens is, imagine you're sitting for very long, right? Like this, you haven't moved. Or that's why they tell you always get up and move so that this also makes you prone to deep vein thrombosis because the blood is sort of not traveling up fast enough. It tends to be sludgy and you can form clots. So imagine you're sitting here and here's a vein in your leg, right? If you're sitting for a very long time, the veins take blood back to the heart. They are dependent on your skeletal muscles contracting and making the blood flow upwards. If you're sitting for very long, no activity, the skeletal muscles are not contracting, what will happen? The blood is not going up, so your veins actually will dilate. They'll become bigger like this. That means there is more fluid now in the veins, more blood in the veins. So the pressure in the veins increases, which means this filtration or what is called hydrostatic pressure increases. Have you followed? When hydrostatic pressure increases, veins and blood vessels have small gaps in them. So fluid passes out into the surrounding tissues. And this makes your foot swell up. If you get up and start walking, because of the skeletal muscles squeezing, what will they do? They will squeeze the veins and, blood will go back and the swelling will come down. Okay, so here you can see it's because of an increase in hydrostatic pressure that fluid has been pushed out and that has caused swelling. So we'll stop here and we'll continue with this on Wednesday.